Well, good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to our first meeting of this year of our Senate Insurance Committee. I'd like to, first of all, say that I'm delighted to once again have Senator Breslin as our ranking member again this year, and we are joined by three of our four new committee members. We're off to a good start with Senator Carlucci, Senator Valesky, and Senator O'Brien. Also, Senator O'Mara is a new member as well of our committee. I'm delighted to once again this year to have our committee director is Allison Cooper, and our committee clerk is Lori Heimrath. And we're joined today, of course, with Rebecca Wood, who is from our Majority Council Program Council's office. Also, with our first meeting, we are delighted to have the superintendent of the Department of Financial Services, Ben Woski, with us as well. And we will be going through our agenda, and then we will be hearing from the superintendent. I would first ask Lori, we have a number of members who have submitted their voting sheets. Would you just let us know who submitted their voting sheets?
I have Senator Flanagan, Senator Golden, Senator Bishante, Senator Lanza, Senator Larkin, Senator Cabal, Senator Martins, Senator O'Mara, Senator Young, and Senator Escaya.
Okay, great. So we, with those members present and those who have submitted voting sheets, we have more than enough members to conduct business. So with that, we will proceed with our agenda. And the first bill is Senate 1959 by Senator Golden.
Yeah. This permits an insurer to retroactively cancel an auto insurance policy within the first 30 days if the initial premium payment was rejected due to the non-existence or unauthorized use of a bank account or unauthorized use of a credit card account.
This bill passed the Senate last year. Are there any questions or comments on this bill? Is there a motion to report the bill? Second. Any negative votes? That bill is reported. Next is Senate 2756.
This is an agreed-upon chapter amendment amending Chapter 495 of the laws of 2012 relating to unclaimed life insurance benefits.
Any questions or comments on this bill? Is there a motion to report? Second. Any negative votes? That bill is reported. Next is Senate 2757.
This is another agreed-upon chapter amendment amending Chapter 496 of the laws of 2012 relating to supplementary uninsured motorist coverage for ambulance services, volunteer fire departments, and voluntary ambulance services.
Any questions or comments? Motion to report. Second, any negative votes? That bill is reported. The next is Senate 2895, and if reported, this would be referred to Finance.
Yep. This will allow New York to join the Interstate Insurance Product Regulation Compact. Will streamline the regulation of certain life insurance products, providing for uniformity among the compacting states.
This is a bill that's passed the Senate a number of times with Senator Breslin's sponsorship, my sponsorship. It's been a bipartisan effort over the years. Just got to get the department on board.
We're becoming so efficient.
Any questions or comments on this bill? Is there a motion to report? That's great. Senator Breslin, second. Any negative votes? That bill is reported to Finance. Next is Senate 3066.
Yep. This allows charities that issue charitable gift annuities to reduce their required reserves by purchasing an annuity contract from a New York admitted life insurer.
Any questions or comments? Once again, this bill has passed the Senate last year. Is there a motion to report? Second. Any negative votes? That bill is reported. And finally is Senate Bill 3539.
Yep. This would permit domestic mutual companies to enter into certain compensation agreements with firms and corporations in which one of its officers or directors has only an indirect pecuniary interest.
Any questions or comments? Is there a motion to report? Second. Any negative votes? That bill is reported as well. Well, that completes our agenda. And next we will move on to, we've asked the superintendent to give some remarks, and we'll obviously he'll be available for any questions. Obviously, having the superintendent here very timely with the weather incidents that we've seen with Superstorm Sandy, and obviously huge insurance implications. We've asked the superintendent to give a report in terms of assessing the industry response to that storm. I know the department's had the report cards that they made available, and any other, superintendent, any other issues that you feel are timely and noteworthy.
Great, thank you very much.
Welcome.
Thank you very much, Chairman Seward, Ranking Member Breslin, members of the committee. It is a pleasure to be here with you today. I can describe the current state of the Department of Financial Services really in one word, and that word is busy. We have been extraordinarily busy with Storm Sandy, but then on the insurance side, just list a few of the things that we've been busy with. Principles-based reserving, captive reinsurance, the implementation of the health exchange, many, many initiatives and work on no-fault fraud and force-placed insurance, as well as just to name a few. And that's just on the insurance side. We're obviously very busy on our banking side as well. When it comes to the Sandy recovery, we worked very, very hard to try and do whatever we could, really at the governor's direction, to help with the Sandy recovery, both by being out in the community and by working with not only the insurance industry, but also the banking industry that we regulate. We have a mobile command center, you've probably heard of it, and it is out constantly moving around to different impacted communities. We were in, despite the snowstorm over the weekend, we were in Staten Island yesterday, we're in Sheepshead Bay today, and we'll just keep getting out there because there are still many, many residents who need help, who have questions about their insurance and about what to do post-Sandy. So that is a function we'll continue to really work hard at. We, over time, staffed numerous locations right after, in the weeks following Sandy, with our staff to help people. I think we were in more than 60 locations over a period of time. We also worked very hard with the insurance industry to get them working as hard as they could. And I should say this about the homeowners insurance industry, the non-flood private insurance industry. They worked very, very hard, and we rode them very, very hard. And they may not have enjoyed it while we were pushing them to be faster and more effective with helping Sandy victims. But at the end of the day, they have already paid on the residential side something like 90% of the claims. And overall, when you include commercial and other claims, they're at about 83% of claims now paid. So they have worked awfully hard. When you compare how the private insurance industry has done in comparison to the flood insurance program run by FEMA, the private insurance industry is running ahead of FEMA, which is a good thing. And I hope that has something to do with the response, the seriousness with which the industry takes its responsibilities, and probably has a little bit to do with we drove them a little crazy by really pushing hard to get the insurance industry to do everything it could to help Sandy victims, because it truly was, when you were out in the communities, really an emergency. And we have found, and we saw it after Irene, upstate especially, that the sooner the insurance money starts to flow in, the faster the communities get back on their feet, and the better they do long term. So we pushed really hard at the governor's direction to do that, and I do think the industry has stepped up their efforts. Can they always do more? Absolutely. And when you see that we have 90% paid, that's great, but there's still another 10%. And those are often, that last 10%, it's like a golf handicap. It's easy to go from a 30 to a 10. Getting the last 10 to a scratch is very, very hard. It's really the perfection. And that final 10% is where we're really focused now. How do we get those claims paid where possible? In many cases, with that remaining 10%, there's a dispute. and it often comes down to what are called these anti-concurrent clauses, where it looks like there are two potential causes of the damage. So you have a sewage backup, which is covered by the homeowner's insurance, but you also have a flood surge, which is not. And how does that get resolved? We're doing a lot of talking internally now at the department about how do we potentially encourage the resolution of those claims, possibly through mediation or non-binding mediation, which could be faster and probably cheaper than litigation. So we're looking at other models. This was something that was done post-Katrina down south. It was something that was done post-Andrew in Florida. And it did have a good effect there. So we're doing a lot of thinking about that right now. So that is really where things stand post-Sandy. Other issues we've been working on recently, obviously, this committee just passed out the unclaimed life benefits chapter amendment today. That was a huge initiative, an issue for us over the last year. And again, I think the governor announced several weeks ago that already over $600 million has flowed back as a result of that initiative to consumers, which is great. And I want to thank both this committee, Chairman Seward and Senator Breslin, and all of you, as well as the life insurance industry, for really working with us on getting the legislation and getting our reg synced up on this issue. And it's a great example of the committee and the governor's office and the department all working together with the industry to, I think, we now will have the best law in the country on this issue going forward. I don't think we'll have any of the kind of problems we saw in the past. So that's a great example of government working together and working well. Other focuses for us are very much, we are focused on no-fault reform and no-fault fraud. As a former prosecutor, I feel personally like it is a legacy DFS should have of really leading the country in fighting no-fault fraud and beating it down. And these staged accidents cases are not only driving up everybody's insurance rates, but they're a danger to people on the streets and people in their cars. So we will be as creative as anybody, and we're very anxious to work with this committee and the industry on doing whatever we can to get rid of that fraud. And again, at the governor's direction, really trying to lead the country, because that cost of no-fault fraud on everybody's car insurance is driving up rates in an unfair way, and it's really something that affects middle-class New Yorkers, and we really should be doing whatever we can to bring those down. We are very busy on the health insurance side with the health exchange, and that will be a continued focus for us. We have a whole group of people working on it, along with a large group from the Department of Health, and that is a very big undertaking, but as of October, we believe, we'll be taking people into the exchange, and it will be up and running as of January 2014. The only other two big areas I'd like to mention before I close is we are continuing to be very focused and look forward to working with the committee on the issues of force-placed insurance, which is as much a banking issue as it is an insurance issue, but that is something that affects a lot of New Yorkers. We had hearings about it last year, and the rates in that industry and the loss ratios are just out of whack, and we need to do something serious about it, because it is contributing to driving people over the foreclosure cliff. And lastly, we've become more and more focused as the years have gone by at DFS on title insurance and what we do about title insurance, and that'll be a big focus, I think, for the next year. We have a rate application in from TIRSA, the rate setting agency, and we want to make sure we focus on setting those rates in a fair and equitable way. Again, like the no-fault rates, that affects a lot of everyday New Yorkers and really hits their bottom line every time they want to either buy a new home or refinance their home. So it's something we'll focus on. And other than that, I really look forward to working with all of you. We will be active. I have three members of the staff here today. Kate Powers over there runs our legislative operation. Kay Diaz, who's next to her, works with her a lot on those issues. She's special counsel to me. And Rob Easton over here in the bold yellow tie is the head of the insurance division and oversees all of those issues. So I want to thank them for being here and thank the committee for listening.
Well, thank you.
And I'm happy to take questions.
Sure. Thank you, Superintendent. We appreciate the update on the industry response in terms of Superstorm Sandy. And I really appreciate your comments on the no-fault fraud. That does continue to be a primary focus of this committee, because we are, everyone is paying more for their auto insurance than they need to be, particularly in the downstate region, because of the, you know, the fraudulent claims. I mean, whenever we can back these out of the system, that's rate relief, you know, for auto insurance rate payers. We'll work very closely with you on that going forward this year. A couple of issues that I just wanted to get your perspective on. The commercial modernization is something that we had done a couple of years ago, and that is due to expire this year, sunset, I should say. And obviously, as we look to streamline regulation where appropriate in New York, I'd be very interested in moving forward once again. I just like your perspective in terms of how you feel that. It's been only 2 years history here, less than 2 years actually, but I'd like your perspective on how you feel this is a benefit to the market here in New York.
Sure. In just the 2 years, I think we've had about 125 carriers get, you know, move under the new law. So I think it has had an impact, and I think it is working. It'd be hard for me to scale it on how successful it's been. And I know there's some talk that maybe the law needs some tweaks as we consider renewing it. And we're very much looking forward to working with you on that. But I think it has had some impact, but maybe not as much as we would have wanted. And very interested in continuing to have that ongoing dialogue. It's hard to comment on how we would, what it should ultimately look like at the end of the day, until we see what it looks like, but we're very much looking forward to working with you.
Great. Well, that will be an issue for us this year. And finally, on the health side, I know the governor's budget calls for, in anticipation of the exchange coming on, that, you know, the elimination of the Healthy New York program, Family Health Plus, which you know, had been a benefit to a great number of businesses and individuals here in New York. Before we, you know, agree to see these programs eliminated, I guess the issue is, will there be a viable alternative, you know, as part of the exchange at an affordable rate, particularly in the Healthy New York side, which is the private. A lot of small businesses take advantage of that. Your perspective there in terms of where we are with the exchange, and you know, we have viable alternatives for these programs.
Yeah, so there has to be viable alternatives for those programs. Absolutely essential. The exchange implementation, as I said, is going very well and speedily, and I think we'll be ahead of almost every other state in terms of being ready to go in January of 2014. The Healthy New York program, because of the funding problems it's had over the last few years, I see the rate applications each year for the prior approval of the rates, and they're going way up. And that really concerns me. So they do affect a lot of small businesses and a lot of people who really need that coverage. But if the rates are going up inexorably, we're going to have a real problem for all of them anyway. And as we're thinking about the health insurance exchange, we're very much focused on what do we do for the pools of businesses and people that fall into that Healthy New York category. And we'll absolutely make sure that they have very viable alternatives and affordable alternatives.
Well, thank you. Senator Breslin?
Just raising on the health exchange, there's been documentation that might be upwards of 1 million who might be eligible for Medicaid, but haven't been signed up. Under the Affordable Care Act, it looks like the federal government will pick up the first couple of years and, for new recipients, and then maybe up to 90% thereafter. Would that include ones who weren't previously signed up but were eligible?
That's a great question. I don't know the answer. I don't want to guess. Yeah. I can get you that answer, and we can get you a briefing on it. But that is a central question.
Yeah, because that would be a nice,
yeah.
Not windfall, but I mean, I think all of us know how important the Affordable Care Act is to signing up the 2.5 million who aren't insured and the underinsured, but it's also, from a practical point of view, a great economic driver. Thank you.
Senator Carlucci?
Thank you for everything the superintendent's done with Sandy and thanking the industry for working with it. I think it's been remarkable when you get down to such a horrendous storm to 10%. And I might add that another vein that I didn't think it was so difficult to get my handicap down to 10.
You are different than me. You're a better golfer than me.
Thank you.
We'll put that on the agenda next meeting. I'd like to learn more about that. Senator Carlucci.
Thank you, Senator Seward. I also want to echo those thoughts on the superintendent being responsive and also proactive. And I know you were recently down in Rockland County with the mobile foreclosure unit. And now, has that unit been transferred over to the mobile?
Yes. Yes, we just changed the signage, to be honest. But at some point, hopefully these storms don't continue, but they probably will continue. And we need to be out there for the foreclosure issue, and we also need to be out there for the storm issue. So I may be coming back to you to ask for another van.
Hey, okay. Well, it was very helpful, and that's what I was wondering. Have you seen a need for that continue? How is that going to go in terms of the foreclosure issue?
The foreclosure numbers, year over year, going into 13, we have a slight uptick, not a big uptick. So that's not what we'd like to see, but it's also not a huge rise. So it continues to be a significant problem, and we will be out, I think, as soon as the weather warms up and the Sandy recovery is a little more stabilized, we'll be back out there doing foreclosure relief. There are a lot of issues related to it that I think hopefully we can help on, specifically servicing issues. So we'll continue to do that. The Attorney General is also very focused on it and is helping a lot with the funding, so that's great. And we'll just continue to do everything we can.
Great. And the point of the 10% left for the residential homes, and you recommended, or you're talking about the mediation, and is that a new course of action for the insurance entity in New York State to do?
Potentially. I mean, again, we're at the thinking about it stage, and I think the stage we're at is we're studying what happened post-Katrina, most specifically, where, again, a lot of the claims get resolved initially, but that remaining whatever percentage is, it is like the golf game, they get those last few strokes.
Right.
Pieces are hard to improve, and what we've seen in the past is they often end up in lengthy, expensive litigation. And if there's a way to avoid that, it's probably better for the state, it's probably better for the industry, it's probably better for people. So we're kicking around, what do we do to try and encourage maybe a non-binding mediation type solution. They did it in Katrina, for example, and I think the non-binding mediation was accepted, non-binding, by both parties, something like 70 to 75% of the time. And so that's a big litigation relief, potentially. But again, we're at the very early stages. We're obviously going to need to think about how it's implemented, if it should be implemented. Obviously going to have to talk a lot with the governor's office about that, too.
Have you found a correlation of specific issues that this 10%, is there a specific issue that's holding them up?
Or? So we're not there yet. The one we've spotted the most is these anti-concurrent clauses, where it looks like there were two causes potentially to the damage, and how do you sort that out? And it often, different insurance companies take different positions on it, and there's a lot of litigation open. It's usually ripe for lengthy litigation, so to the extent we can resolve these, rather than have that litigation, we'd like to see that potential.
Thank you. Anyone else with a question or comment? Senator O'Brien.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. This is maybe too global of questions to really get much of an answer today, but I'd love to learn more about it over time as a new to this committee. But when you think about New York State and historically what has been kind of an economic driver, like the auto industry in Michigan, there's been financial services, and certainly insurance is part of that.
Yep.
And I guess what I'd like to understand, at least over time, It's whether or not, in your view, we're doing enough to kind of protect, nourish the insurance industry in New York so there's a motivation to, for companies to be here and have it grow.
Yeah, it's a great question. It's probably worthy of a longer conversation, but I can tell you I was speaking with the life insurance industry at an event on Thursday afternoon, and I asked that very question to them because a year ago I'd spoken to the same group and said, you know, our door is open. We have people whose sole job it is to try and, at the governor's direction, help create jobs through your industry. And my hope is that you can get to the point where you're coming in the doors of DFS and sitting down with our people and saying, how can we strategize about opening up a new office in Utica or in, name your upstate location. And
Rochester.
Cooperstown.
Albany.
Rockland. So we are very focused on that. And I admit, though, I was disappointed over the last year that we didn't do more of that. And that may just be the nature of the economy right now. I mean, with interest rates set at historically low levels and not looking to rise much over the next 2 years, at least, that puts the life insurance industry with that long tail risk in a very tough place. So I don't know that there's anything anybody could do to really get them to grow in the United States. They're growing a lot overseas. So, but there are, it's certainly a focus and it's certainly a priority for the governor. So we'll continue to do that. I'd love to keep talking with you about it.
Thanks. Well, thank you. If there are no other questions, I just want to thank the superintendent for joining us here today. And I was reminded as you were talking about the Sandy storm and the response to this and the van, the insurance department van being out there. Back in 2011, when Irene hit my area, and particularly in the Schoharie Valley and part of the Catskills, we had that van up. It was very, very helpful to many people, as well as I remember going probably business to business
through
the superintendent.
Yeah.
He toured there, and I can report to you, Mr. Superintendent, Mrs. Case in Middleburg is open and doing very, very well.
I visit her every time I pass through there.
There you go. No wonder she's doing so well.
Yeah.
Well, again, thank you all very, very much, and this concludes our meeting.
Thank you.